My name is Roger Cate. I'm an adult neurologist. I work at the National Hospital for Neurology and Neurosurgery in London. And we're one of the centres that provides a national mitochondrial service for patients. So the title of my talk is Current Treatment Strategies. And I feel a little bit like a warm-up for E and Bobby, because I know that though that talk, in particular the research updates and the clinical trials, is likely to be hotly anticipated, and for good reason, really. It's really a very exciting time at the moment for treatment in genetic diseases, and we're really in a new era. We've gone through a kind of genetics revolution where we've been able to diagnose far more patients because of the changes in the technology that we use to analyse DNA. And what that's enabled us to do is start thinking much more about developing more treatments in genetic diseases. And mitochondrial disease is no exception. And so there are all sorts of really exciting strategies for approaching this conundrum, because as you're all aware, unfortunately, we don't have a treatment to reverse the progression of mitochondrial disease or cure mitochondrial disease. But there are a number of really exciting possibilities being investigated at the moment. Most of these are at the preclinical stage that I'm showing here. I'm not expecting you to see this, but they include changing the DNA, both the mitochondrial DNA and the nuclear DNA that Andy alluded to during his talk, delivering new proteins into the mitochondria to correct the dysfunctional protein caused by the DNA mutation, new drugs that target mitochondria via a whole host of different mechanisms, and also stem cell approaches. And although, as I just said, many of those strategies are at the preclinical phase, which basically means looking at them in the petri dish in cells or in animal models of disease, this is taken from the Clinical Trials Gov website just this month. So these are all the trials that are active, so they're currently recruiting, or they're fully recruited, or they're analysing data, and these are phase 2 clinical trials. So these are trials focused on whether a treatment works in patients with mitochondrial disease. So these aren't phase 1 trials, which are really looking at safety or trying to find the right dose to use. These are actually looking to see if they work. And there are 15 different trials on this list, which is incredibly exciting, because even 10 years, even 5 years ago, there would be very few trials, if any, on this list. So things are moving very quickly, so it's a very exciting time. I'm sure Bobby will touch on some of this. But what about now? So what have we got at the moment? And as I alluded, we don't have a treatment that is clinically approved that we can use to reverse the progression or cure mitochondrial disease, but it's still important to know that we have a huge amount that we can do to help our patients. So really, defining what a treatment is the first thing. And I think from my point of view, is anything that improves a patient's quality of life. And there are lots of things that we can do that do that. So in terms of what I want to touch on in the talk, I want to talk a little bit about the kind of drug therapies we have, and these are mainly vitamins and related substances. And some of these are treating the underlying condition, some of these are helping the symptoms. And then it's also important to highlight a number of very specific diseases that we can treat with these that are possibly more responsive to the treatments that we have. And I'll mention what those are. I've included exercise and dietary modification. I'm not going to spend much time on that because they've also been covered by previous speakers. Probably the most important part of the talk is the health surveillance and monitoring. So understanding and knowing what complications of disease can arise, recognising them and treating them early. And finally, I'm going to end by talking about emergency plans and the acute management of mitochondrial disease, which again is really important. So recognising those warning signs when either your child or yourself are becoming unwell is absolutely essential to seek medical attention early, because when you have mitochondrial disease and you're put under some sort of stress, things can you can become poorly very, very quickly. Okay, so these are the sorts of vitamins and cofactors and food supplements that are pretty regularly discussed in our clinic. in terms of whether they might help with an individual's mitochondrial disease. And a very good review of all the treatments that have been studied in mitochondrial disease was undertaken and updated in 2012. And there were over 1,300 different studies looking at treatments in mitochondrial disease. But it was quite sobering that only 12 of these were well-designed studies. And when we say well-designed, what we tend to mean is randomized, placebo-controlled, double-blinded trials. So this basically means you tend to have one active molecule, a drug, and you compare it with a sham, a sort of dummy that doesn't work at all, and you can't tell the difference between the two. The two groups of patients are then allocated randomly by a computer to one or the other. And then the doctor and the patient, neither of them knows which they're taking, whether it's a placebo or a drug, and the whole trial is undertaken like that. And what that does, it takes away the bias that can sometimes be introduced into studies. Because, you know, as doctors, we want treatments to work just as the patients want the treatments to work. And so there's a subconscious component. If you know the patient wasn't on the treatment, that you introduce this bias and that potentially gives you spurious results. And the last thing we want is for that. And for them, you know, spending precious resources on drugs that actually aren't really helping. So the good quality trials, these randomized, placebo-controlled, double-blind trials, the 12 of them, looked at those vitamins there. And unfortunately, none of them showed any evidence of any significant benefit. That doesn't mean they're definitely not going to help on an individual basis, but in the trials that were undertaken using them, as a whole, there was no significant improvement in the mitochondrial disease. One positive thing that has come out of those trials is they appeared safe. So this is just a breakdown of the trials. Again, I don't worry if you can't see the specifics, but this goes into a little bit more detail about them. And just some aspects that I wanted to just to pull out is the number of people involved. So if this was a heart failure or a diabetes or a cancer trial, the number of patients in that trial will be hundreds or even thousands of patients. Now, two or three of these trials did look at a reasonable number of patients, so you're getting 30s and 40s, which is not bad for a rare disease. The other issue you can see here is that the mixture of patients that were recruited to the trial. So these were patients that perhaps had different clinical problems or perhaps had different genetic causes of those different problems. And if you could choose, you would have a very, very homogenous group of people with the same set of clinical problems at the same stage in their life, caused by the same genetic defect, to maximise your chance of seeing an effect of your molecule. Now, we don't have that advantage in rare disease, of which mitochondrial disease is considered. And so we have to be clever about designing trials to maximise the likelihood of us seeing an effect. Because it's not necessary that these tablets on this list didn't work because they're never going to work in mitochondrial disease. It just might be that there weren't enough patients that were looked at. There weren't enough patients with the same clinical problems, or perhaps patients with the same genetic diagnosis. Or even maybe the sorts of measures that we use to determine whether a treatment is working, maybe they weren't the right measures. So it's really important that we're clever in the future about designing these trials and who should be recruited to. So of all those vitamins that I mentioned there, really one group, and in fact one particular vitamin in that group, is one that we use. So this one here, coenzyme Q10, and it's in a group of antioxidants. So what are antioxidants? Well, basically, that's a mitochondria, and as you probably know, the enzymes in the mitochondria are known as the respiratory chain. And they form a series of reactions. So food goes in, it gets burnt with oxygen, and energy comes out again. And during that process, these things called free radicals or reactive oxygen species are produced. And that's absolutely normal. That's happening in all of us. And in fact, some people think that contributes to the aging process. The reason we age is these free radicals, which are sort of damaging to the cell. Although, more recently, we appreciate that they also have probably a positive function on the way that the cells talk to each other. So if something goes wrong with those enzyme reactions, what happens is more free radicals get produced, so more reactive oxygen species. And so if you've got a mitochondrial disease, there are far more free radicals, reactive oxygen species, than would be normally present, and therefore they're doing damage. And actually, no matter what the genetic basis of your mitochondrial disease, the end result is often that series of enzymes isn't working as well as it should do, and you're getting more of these free radicals. So it makes sense that you should use an antioxidant which basically mops up these free radicals and reduces the damage that's ongoing. And so what we tend to do is, with this coenzyme Q10, which is one of these antioxidants, we start it at a low dose, and we start by doing a fatigue score. So it tends to be something that helps. If anything, it helps with fatigue. So we confirm how fatigued someone is at the beginning. We start the coenzyme Q10, we increase the dose a little bit, and after 3 or 4 months, we'll repeat the fatigue score again, and we'll see if that's helping. And if the fatigue score has improved, then we think, well, it's clearly doing something in that individual, and so we would continue it. If it's not, then we have a discussion, and often we stop it at that point, because there's really no point being on a treatment or a vitamin if we don't think it's doing any good. So that's our strategy for using coenzyme Q10, which is really the only treatment that we routinely prescribe in our clinic. And I'd say that's the same across the other centres as well in Oxford and Newcastle, particularly in the adults. So coenzyme Q10 is something we prescribe in anyone with mitochondrial disease, doesn't matter what the underlying cause is. But there are a number of very specific scenarios, specific situations, where there's a primary problem with a vitamin or cofactor, either the way it's absorbed or transported through the body, the way it's produced in the body. And actually, in those specific situations, replacing that enzyme or that vitamin can be very helpful. And in fact, you tend to get a greater benefit than this kind of generic, just giving it to anyone. So there are a number of diseases, again, I don't expect you necessarily to read those, but it's a number of diseases that we are aware of, that we look for specifically so we can treat them. And some of you might be familiar with things, vitamins like riboflavin and thiamine and coenzyme Q10, and we use those in specific scenarios when we've identified a specific problem in their production or their transport around the body. But this tends to be a very well-circumscribed group of individuals who have these problems that we diagnose on genetic screening. And we shouldn't also not forget there are some mitochondrial diseases that just get better on their own. So people, the children can be very, very poorly early in life and then spontaneously improve after months and months, for instance, on intensive care. They just get better without any specific treatment. And so it's always important to be switched on to that possibility that could happen in specific, as I say, specific cases. Okay, so I'm going to move away from vitamins and cofactors, and I'm going to touch on exercise and diet, and say, because that's been mentioned already in greater detail, I'm not going to spend too long on this. So exercise is important for everyone. So it's important for your general fitness, it's important for your muscles, it's important for your heart and your circulation. And we know that if you're unfit, if you're deconditioned, then it has a negative effect on your muscles. And so it makes sense in any muscle disease, not just mitochondrial disease, that if you become unfit, that's going to have a greater effect than someone who doesn't have a muscle disease. The additional component in mitochondrial disease is that in many patients with mitochondrial disease, we know there are a mixture of good and healthy mitochondria, and this is specifically linked to the patients with mitochondrial DNA-related disease. And there is some evidence to say that exercise can increase the good mitochondria, and what that does is it boosts the level of ATP and therefore reduces symptoms. But this is really a theory. It's been looked at in animals and in the preclinical phase, but it's really a theory, and we're currently looking at larger clinical trials to kind of analyse this a bit more. But the current advice is to exercise regularly at a level that's comfortable, but without pushing yourself so you feel terrible the next day. And that's best done really under the care of a physiotherapist, especially a physiotherapist. And Jane in Newcastle and Sarah in London tailor exercise regimes for their patients to make sure they're doing exactly the right amount for them. Diets, I really don't want to spend too much time on this because this is you've had an excellent talk about this previously, but just to say that the ketogenic diets, there is a lot of literature on using the ketogenic diet in mitochondrial disease for a number of reasons that are theoretical, really, but we don't have any good randomised double-blind controlled trial data on this. There are definitely specific examples, PDH deficiency, you've mentioned earlier, and also epilepsy, where it's pretty well established in the treatment, but this has to be done under the guidance of a specialist dietitian who's familiar with the diet, because what we often find in patients who sometimes self-prescribe the ketogenic diet is they lose a lot of weight, and as many of you know, it's difficult to put weight on anyway with mitochondrial disease, so the last thing you want to do is be losing weight and having and that affecting your nutrition. Okay, so moving on to health surveillance and monitoring. So, as Andy mentioned, mitochondrial disease is incredibly variable because mitochondria are everywhere in our bodies. So if they're not working, potentially a number of different organs, a number of different tissues can be affected. And so it's really important that you've got different specialists involved checking up on these different systems to make sure they're working properly. And that's why I think having a mitochondrial specialist who may not be specialist in all these different systems, although is expert in mitochondrial disease, is really useful, because if they can take a step back and say, right, are you seeing the right people? Are you having annual checks by the right people? Are you seeing the cardiologist? Are you seeing the respiratory doctor? And that's a lot of what we're doing with our patients. We're making sure they're plugged into the right services and we can coordinate that. So you can have laser treatment for eye problems and ptosis surgery and cataract surgery. We can use seizure medications for epilepsy and botulinum toxin injections and drugs for stiffness in the muscles, and even surgery to release muscle tension. There are hearing aids and cochlear implants for people with deafness. People with nerve problems, it's very important to have good foot care, orthotics, and potentially surgery. I've already mentioned with myopathy, so muscle weakness and fatigue, how important exercise and physiotherapy, occupational therapy. Coenzyme Q10 can help to a certain extent in energy conservation. If you've got problems with your glands, we can help with that, with diet and drugs. There are a number of problems, again, with the gastrointestinal system that can occur, the kidneys, the liver. So, you know, really good control of bowel function with laxatives and the right diet, dialysis for kidneys if they're not working, transplants, and that also applies to the heart, which, again, we can use drugs, pacemakers, and for the lungs where we can give ventilator support. So there's a whole host of things there that we can do, and these will have hugely positive effects on people's quality of life. But it's really important that we're looking for them and that people are aware of these complications and that they can occur in people with mitochondrial disease and we treat them early. And we've got an excellent website, both for patients and professionals, which the Lilly Foundation have really helped with, and it really is a fantastic resource. And so there's no excuse for a doctor to turn around and say, I don't really know what mitochondrial disease is, I don't really know, you know, how we should treat it. Just direct them to this website and all the guidance is there. So I just want to finish on a couple of slides, emergency plans and acute management. So this is our emergency plan. This is the one we use in London, and there's both Oxford and Newcastle have similar emergency plans. And so every single one of our patients with mitochondrial disease has one of these, and it's tailored to them. It's tailored to their specific disease and their genetic diagnosis. So they become unwell, they can take it to the GP, or they can take it to the emergency department, and they can give it to the doctor and say, this is what I have. You know, these are the people that are involved in my care, this is their contact information. And we've also got lots of information about how to treat various complications of the disease that might arise whilst we're in hospital. So there's a huge amount of information there. But what's also really important is knowing what problems can arise quite quickly when you become unwell with mitochondrial disease. And this tends to happen when you've got an infection, when you're dehydrated, as you've heard, when you start a new medication, or sometimes for no specific reason that you can identify at all. And these are the sorts of warning signs, the red flags that everyone needs to be really familiar with, that this is heralding potentially a problem that can get worse quite quickly. So nausea and vomiting, confusion, or being quite sleepy or irritable, weakness down one side, or problems with speech, problems with vision or hearing, seizures, bad headaches, and sudden problems with bowel, so not being able to go to the toilet for long periods of time. These can all suggest that you know, something is going on, whatever's caused it, it might not be clear, but something's going on, seek medical attention. And that should be GP, but if unwell, really unwell, straight to accident emergency. And as Victoria mentioned, if you've got access to direct to the ward, that's fantastic. I think in adult cases, adult patients, that often isn't the case. And because we want to make sure all of these things are treated early, because if you leave them, they get harder to treat. So seizures are treated really early, fluids are given to maintain hydration in a drip, antibiotics are given in a drip to really treat the infection aggressively, and correction of the acid that can build up when the mitochondria aren't working properly. And as I say, it's really important to recognise these problems as soon as they even vaguely start, because things can get worse very quickly when the mitochondria are stressed. Okay, so I'm going to finish there. So there's huge amounts of excitement in terms of the treatments and the pipeline for mitochondrial diseases. But I really want to emphasise there's a lot we can do right now. Unfortunately, there's no clear evidence from our current trials of different drugs, vitamins and cofactors. And generally, the only tablet that we prescribe is coenzyme Q10, although in very specific situations that I mentioned, other vitamins in addition to coenzyme Q10 can be very useful, and we can see a greater benefit. However, I can't emphasise enough how important the surveillance and the monitoring of people's health is, seeing the right specialists, being treated early, and recognising those early warning signs to avoid people becoming really sick and spending lots of time in hospital. I'd just like to stop there.